Good morning, dear friends. Myself, Dr. Jyoti Gangurde. Now, I am going to teach you the subject that is Entomology 1. Paper that is ZOUT 231. And the chapter that is Integument. And now we are going to discuss on the topic that is Biosynthesis of Chitin. So, how the chitin is synthesized or how the formation of chitin. So, the biosynthesis of chitin in insect, it is an important, what we say is that it having a pathway. So, the chitin is important protein. So, the chitin which is synthesized by the insect epidermis. Here, the active chitin monomers are secreted into the extracellular apophyseal spaces where such monomers, they are polymerized to form a chain, or such a formation of chain which is takes place by means of the enzyme that is chitin synthetase. So, here such a chitin synthesis in insect which is controlled by 20 hydroxyiodosone, and again such a chitin synthesis process which is pH and temperature dependent chemical process. Now, the chitin synthesis which takes place via a metabolic pathway of 8 or more steps. Such a steps, they convert the trihalose which is present in the insect hemolymph into the end product of the reaction, that is nothing but the chitin, or what we say is that the N-acetyl glucosamine. So, here you know about the hemolymph. Hemolymph, which is nothing but the blood of insect, it is in majority what we say that here the hemolymph which is colorless, they having the cells, various kind of cells are there. So, in the hemolymph, such a trihalose is present. Now, such a trihalose which get converted into the chitin by a pathway. So, here we discuss the biosynthesis of chitin pathway. So, here the trihalose, very first the trihalose from the hemolymph which get converted into the glucose, that is into the sugar, by means of an enzyme that is trihalase. Such a glucose again which form its simpler form which get break down to form again glucose 6-phosphate by the enzyme that is hexokinase. Again, the next step, that is the glucose 6-phosphate which get converted into fructose 6-phosphate. Here, the formation of fructose 6-phosphate with the help of enzyme, that is glucose phosphate isomerase. Now, the fructose 6-phosphate here converted into glucosamine 6-phosphate. Such a glucosamine 6-phosphate which is formed by an enzyme, that is glutamine fructose 6-phosphate aminotransferase, where the glutamine which get converted into glutamic acid. Now, in the next step, where the glucosamine 6-phosphate which get converted into N-acetyl glucosamine 6-phosphate by an enzyme, that is glucosamine 6-phosphate N-acetyl transferase, where the acetyl coenzyme A, which get converted into coenzyme A. Now the N-acetyl glucosamine 6-phosphate, which again get converted into again its simpler form, that is into 1-phosphate or in single phosphate. So the N-acetyl glucosamine 6-phosphate, which get converted into N-acetyl glucosamine 1-phosphate by an enzyme, that is phosphoacetyl glucosamine mutase. Now such a N-acetyl glucosamine 1-phosphate, which get converted into uridine diphosphate N-acetyl glucosamine, where such a uridine diphosphate N-acetyl glucosamine is formed by an enzyme, that is uridine diphosphate N-acetyl glucosamine pyrophosphorylase. So where here the UTP, that is uridine triphosphate, which get converted into, that is pyrophosphate. Now here such a uridine diphosphate N-acetyl glucosamine, which get converted into a end product of the pathway, that is chitin, or particularly we says that N-acetyl glucosamine. And here the enzyme, that is chitin synthetase, where here the uridine triphosphate, which form the product of the reaction, that is uridine diphosphate. So students, this is what the pathway, what we say is that the metabolic pathway, where the biosynthesis of chitin, which takes place from the trehalose, which is present in the hemolymph of insect, which get converted by a metabolic steps, by a cyclical steps, into the end product, that is nothing but the chitin. So as we know that the chitin, which is nothing but the chitin microfibrils and different type of proteins such as arthropodin, resilin, like this. So the chitin microfibrils, again they have the types such as alpha chitin, beta chitin and gamma chitin, and they have again different models. Now you can see here, this is the structure of chitin. So this is the molecular structure of the chitin, and here this is the polymorph, that is here you can see alpha microfibril, beta microfibril, or here the gamma microfibril. Now we focused on the cuticular modifications. So here the chitin, which is the protective layer, or what we say is that the cuticular modifications. So here the cuticular modifications, the types such as the macrotrichia, the microtrichia, spines, apodins, apophyses, then cuticular membranes as well as ecdysial lines. So first we focused on the macrotrichia. Now here the macrotrichia, macro that is large, trachea hair like structures, such a large size hair like structures, they are present all over the body of insect, that is macrotrachia. Such a trachea, they are hollow structures, they are exocuticular in their invaginations. So the macrotrachia are the hollow hairy exocuticular processes. They are having a great taxonomic importance, as their distribution differ from species to species. Suppose you are taking example, that is suppose on the legs, hairs are present. So foreleg, mid leg, hind leg. So on the foreleg, such hairs they are present, they having varying in length, varying in its thickness. Not necessary such hairs they are present on the mid leg and either on the hind leg. So they have a great taxonomic importance. That's why they having the importance. So they have the different types, such as clothing hairs, glandular hairs, sensory hairs, and the wing scales. So first discuss on the clothing hairs. The clothing hairs, again the name itself indicate, clothing means all over the body. Such hairs they are present all over the body of insect. So clothing hairs that covers the entire body and the appendages of insect, and the common example suppose we are taking, that is honeybee. So on the body of honeybee, all over the body, such a hairs they are present, or what we say is that the clothing hairs. Now the second type, that is glandular hair. Again here the glandular means such a hairs they are present surrounding or around the openings of the glands, particularly in case of insects surrounding the epidermal glands. So the glandular hairs, they occurring around the opening of various epidermal glands, and they can be seen, suppose few examples such as few lepidopteran larvae. So not all, but few lepidopteran larvae. Now the third example, that is sensory hairs. So the sensory hairs, again here the name itself indicates, such hairs they give sensation to the body of insect. So such a sensory hair, they acting as a mechanoreceptor or either acting as a chemoreceptor. So such a hairs, they are present on the antenna, again on the mouth parts, on the legs, again on the various body regions in all group of insects. So here suppose we are taking example of cockroach having long antenna. So if we can touch to cockroach, even so cockroach is go far away, or within a short time cockroach will run fast. So it is what? Tactile in nature. So what? It is a mechanoreceptor, or again chemoreceptor also. So the next type, that is the wing scale. The wing scales, they are the modified and varyingly pigmented microplate like structures. Such a microplate like structures that invade to the wing surfaces of adult butterflies as well as moths. Means on the surfaces of wings of butterflies and moths, such a scales are present, or on the basis of such a wing scales, they have a great taxonomic importance, which kind of scales are present. So on the basis of that, such a moth, such a butterflies, they can categorize into orders, into families. So they have a great taxonomic importance. So this is what about the macrotracheas. Now the next cuticular modification, that is the microtrachea. Micro, again micro means very fine. Such a fine sensory hairs they are present, and such a hairs they haven't or without articulation at their bases. So the sensory hairs constituting, microtracheas have the fine sensory hairs without having the basal articulation, and they confine to the wings in some Macroptera as well as in some Dipteran flies. So such a fine sensory hair like structure or hairy structure, they are present in case of Macroptera. Macroptera means here scorpion flies, or either hanging flies. On those flies, such as microtracheas are present, and again in some dipteran flies, suppose you are taking example dipteran flies as a mosquito, as a house fly. So on that flies, such a micro hair like processes are present. That is nothing but the microtrachea. Now the next cuticular modification, that is spines. So here the spines can be seen as the cuticular process in some insect. Suppose we are taking example the aquatic dragonfly larvae. So where such a spines they are present on the body of such a dragonfly larvae, because you know the dragonfly, which is a terrestrial insect, or their developing stages they are aquatic. So on the larvae of dragonfly, such a spines on the body of such a dragonfly larvae, such a spines they are present, or such a spines, these are nothing but the cuticular processes. Suppose again we are taking the next example, such as adult beetles having a cuticular horn on the apical region of the head. So the second example, that is suppose we are taking example of beetle, adult beetle, where at the front region of the head, at the apical region of the head, such a pointed structure is present for the protection, or again they have different function. Or here particularly in case of male beetle, such a apical spines are present, but such a apical spines they are absent in case of female beetle. So by this we can easily differentiate between the male and female beetles. So such a structures represent the highly modified cuticular processes, and they are again having the epidermal multicellular origin. Now this is what about the spines. Spines, they are useful for protection. Again in some insect they are useful for the sex determination, either they are male or female, and they have different function. Now we can discuss the next, that is the apodemes and apophyses. So here the apodemes or the apophyses, these are the two types of cuticular invaginated processes. Here the hollow invaginations you can see in the diagram. Here two diagrams are there. Here this is the hollow invagination and this is the solid invagination. So the hollow invagination, which is nothing but the apodeme, and the solid invagination, which is nothing but the apophysis. So here the hollow invaginations, they are called the apodemes, and here the apodemes, they are useful, they are the site of attachment of the muscles, whereas the solid invaginations, they are called as apophyses. So these structures, they form the endofragmental skeleton inside the body of insect. So such a apophyses, such a structures, they form, or both, that is apophyses or apodemes, these structures they form the endofragmental skeleton inside the body of insect, which provide mechanical support to the various organs and to the whole body of insect. Means they give mechanical support inside of the body of insect. So they form distinct skeletal structure as the tentorium in case of head, or as the endothorax in case of the thorax. Now the next cuticular modification, that is cuticular membranes. So the cuticular membranes in some regions of the integument, the exocuticle, which is discontinuous due to the lack of tanning. So in the integument, particularly in the exocutical region, in the executical region, where the what we say is that we cannot show the tanning. A particular region is there, we cannot see the tanning. So due to the lack of tanning, such a membranes they are formed. What here? In some regions of the integument, the executicle is discontinuous due to the lack of tanning, and therefore such a part of the cuticle which remain membranous. And now by this way the cuticular membranes are formed. So these membranes are flexible and perform the intersegmental, intrinsic or extrinsic articulation according to their location. So such a cuticular membranes are formed at the exocuticular region. And now here the last cuticular modification, that is ichdysial line. So ichdysial line I already discussed in previous lecture also. So ichdysial line, which is also called as the line of weakness. So how the ichdysial line is formed? So the ichdysial line, so in case of the larvae, at the various region of head and thorax, here the exocuticle is absent. So the exocuticle is absent, forming the ichdysial line. So particularly in the developing stage, in case of the larvae, at various region of its head and its thorax, the exocuticle is wanting, the exocuticle is absent, where at that region a particular line is formed, or what we say is that the line of weakness or the ichdysial line. So due to the absence of exocuticle, the ichdysial line becomes very weak, along which the adult or along which the cuticle of exovi splits at the time of ichdysis. So I already explained the procedure, how insect or how the developing stage which come outside from the previous cuticle, previous old cuticle. So here the when the insect or the when the developing stage which showing the molting, that time the particular pressure is exerted on the thorax, on the head of the body of particular developing stage, where such a pressure which exerted on the line of weakness. So the line of weakness, which is already a delicate or a thin membrane, so which splits easily by exerting the body pressure, inside body pressure, so through which the developing stage which come out from the old cuticle. So this is what the function of the line of weakness or the ichdysial line. So and that's why such a ichdysial line, which is called as the line of weakness. So the developing stage which come easily outside the old cuticle. So this is what about all the cuticular modifications. Now here you can see, here this is the membrane which is formed at the exocuticular region due to again the lack of tanning, and here you can see the ichdysial line at the exocuticular region where the absence of exocuticle. So the cuticular membrane, and this is the ichdysial line. Okay, thank you.